everyone. Welcome to the Ultimate Bondcast, where five superfans have come together to rank every single movie from 25th to 1st. So at the end, we have an average amongst all of our scores so that we can answer that age-old question of which Bond movie is the best and which is the worst, using a unique format that we haven't really seen before. I'll explain how we're going to do this in a bit. Right now, let's just go around the table and everyone quickly introduce yourselves. Bob, why don't you start? Tell us who you are, how you got into Bond, what was your first Bond movie, and I don't know, anything that makes you, like, what makes you a super fan?
My name is Bob Mitch. I'm a huge James Bond fan. My first James Bond film was For Your Eyes Only, which I watched incessantly. I reenacted scenes from it on my stair banisters in my living room, probably much to my parents' dismay.
Which scene?
The helicopter hanging out with the helicopter. I would hang out at the banister and pretend that the patio was going to suck me down. My dad got me into all this stuff. He was a big Bond fan, and so he just kind of ushered me in. It was my gateway drug. I have since gotten into Eurospy, Mission Impossible, Avengers, and Man from U.N.C.L.E. And that, I think, also gives me kind of a very grand, big spy perspective on the whole thing.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's just followed me my whole life. I eventually worked in post-production and doing some freelance writing, so that gave me that kind of professional angle on it as well. Like Brad and Athena at this table, I did a James Bond marathon in 2012 where I ranked every single Bond film with other people, and that was kind of fun. So I've already kind of been in that mindset. And of course, with Costume Station Zero and Trek to Trek, I've been reviewing things like Star Trek and Doctor Who on a regular basis. So I'm so thrilled to turn the critical eye to James Bond, which in many ways is essentially my first fandom.
Bob is a podcast pro, and we're very thankful that he's hosting.
Yay.
Ryan, why don't you explain who you are,
how
you got into Bond, first Bond movie?
Well, I'm Ryan Preventure, and I got into Bond, like you, because of my dad. My dad was a huge Bond fan of the movies and the books, and when I was a kid, he'd read me excerpts of some of the Ian Fleming books, but
cool.
I was a kid,
awesome.
So there wasn't so much you can do. And I remember when I was going off into second grade, when, you know, you get introduced to all your teachers, my mom said to me, just don't say your name is Bond, James Bond. Just tell them your real name.
Yep.
We don't want to start with that. But that's how I got into Bond. My dad showed me Goldfinger. Was the first one I saw on VHS, and then the first one I saw in the movie theater was A View to a Kill.
How old were you when you first saw Goldfinger?
I was 6 or 7.
Wow.
So I was pretty young.
Awesome.
Yeah. So I've been a Bond fan pretty much my whole life. You know, I do remember one moment, you know, this sort of the turning around that Bond does with the gun and all this, you know, sort of promos and stuff. I did that once with a Walter PPK that I had, and it hit one of my mom's vases and destroyed the vase. So that's one of my sad Bond moments that I have.
I'm guessing this wasn't a real PPK.
It was not a real.
Okay.
It was a toy. It was a toy gun, but it was close enough that it damaged,
right,
destroyed the vase. So. But I'd say I was a super fan when I was in high school. I was the head of our band, and your senior year, you got to conduct whatever you wanted, and I got to conduct the James Bond theme in Goldfinger.
That's
so
awesome. Awesome.
I got to do that, and it's I actually put it on YouTube. So
I'm going to have to watch that later.
Yeah, I'll have to watch that later.
Awesome,
so,
cool.
That's me.
Awesome. John.
Cool. My name is John Cox. I actually write a blog called The Book Bond. And my first James Bond movie I ever saw was Diamonds Are Forever, when it premiered on television. I was pretty young, because I don't know when that premiered on ABC, but, you know, say 72.
Mm-hmm.
So I was, you know, 8 years old or something. And that had a tremendous impact. And I remember sort of thinking, this was adult. This is the world of adults.
Oh, yeah.
And it's exactly like reality.
It felt sexy and interesting.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
And that Plenty O'Toole is,
yeah,
going to bed thinking about her. And I never thought about a woman before.
Awesome.
And I also,
nice,
remember thinking, I don't know who that fat guy was, because the Bond that I was familiar with was from the cover of Man with the Golden Gun,
right,
which was in stores.
So
and I saw Bond as sort of the lean Brit.
Right.
I remember thinking, who's this kind of
with the weird hairpiece? And
but then by the end, I'm like, but he's awesome. That's
cool.
A man.
Yeah, awesome.
But the first movie I saw in the theater, which really made me a fan, was The Spy Who Loved Me. And I'd say I kind of became a super fan, though, around the beginning of the 80s, on the run-up to Free Eyes Only. The John Gardner books started happening, so I became a fan of Bond, not just the movies, but also the books.
We should also mention that, John, you have written screenplays.
Yes, yes.
We should. That's, I think that's very important.
You made a living doing that.
Yeah.
I made a living doing it, and, yeah.
Athena.
Hey, Hey, my name is Athena Stamos, and when I was 9 years old, I watched this wonderful little cartoon called James Bond Jr.
James Bond Jr.
Leon, it worked.
one person.
You did it.
But as far as the real movies go, when I was 15, I traveled to Switzerland and Greece with my mom, and we visited some locations, Piz Gloria from On Her Majesty's Secret Service, and the monasteries in
For Your Eyes Only.
And I found out about the movies then, so when I got back home, I started watching the film, starting with On Her Majesty's Secret Service.
That was your first movie?
That was my first movie. And it was fabulous. So then in 2003, I started reporting about Bond news on a website called CommanderBond.net.
Yeah.
And I got to experience the chaos of the casting of Daniel Craig. From there, in 2011, I hosted a Bondathon for my birthday, so watching all the movies in order and ranking them, and this was like no sleep.
Yeah, we 3 days. No sleep. Yeah. Which, by the way, I should mention, you can watch that on YouTube. Type in Ultimate Bondathon, and you can see. I bet you, though, our rankings are probably, because I think a lot of us were there, I think our rankings are probably going to be different now.
Oh, they're definitely different. And what else? I've been to 3 Bond movie premieres, Quantum of Solace, Skyfall, and Spectre.
In London, yeah. And what car do you drive?
Oh, and I drive a BMW Z3 from the movie GoldenEye.
Well, it's not literally the car, but it looks just like it.
The colors are the same.
Yeah.
And it has a wonderful Bond-inspired license plate.
It does, yeah. Cool. And my name is Brad, and I think I'm a bit different than most of you guys. I got into Bond kind of late. I had never seen anything Bond related until I was 14. Tomorrow Never Dies came out, and when you're 14, that is the perfect movie to get into Bond, because, you know, I'm a big car guy, and there's lots of car stuff, and it's a really fun action movie at the time. I saw it and was like, oh my god, this is the best thing ever. In like the year after that, I did nothing but watch Bond movies, going to Blockbuster. Remember those? VHS. Remember those? Watching all those in whatever order they could get, reading all the books. Just, I was like a sponge. In like 1 year, I went from not having seen anything or read anything to having basically read, played all the video games, everything all together in like 1 year, and never really looked back. It basically became an obsession after that point. I got into filmmaking. I've even directed a feature called Driver's Ed Mutiny. And so hopefully I can bring a little more of the filmmaking expertise to someone who's like been there. So I'm really excited to be doing this finally with all you guys. So let me go around and explain a bit about the rules of our ranking. So we are covering all 24 official Eon-produced films from Dr. No to Spectre, as well as Never Say Never Again, as we felt it was directly comparable. Whereas the 1954 and 1967 versions of Casino Royale will not be included. Each of us came up with our rankings in any way we saw fit, but with two caveats, okay? Number one, we had to look at each film as a whole when it came to our rankings, by looking at all the different components of what makes a good Bond movie instead of just focusing in on one component. For example, I couldn't say that Skyfall is the best James Bond movie just because I thought it had the best title song. Now, I could say that Skyfall was the best Bond film because it has the best title song and the best story and the best action and villains and locations, gadgets, etc. The idea is it takes more than one element to make a truly great Bond film, okay? And then the second thing was, and this was really tough, I think, for all of us, is that we were asked to remove personal nostalgia from influencing our rankings. Now, by personal nostalgia, I mean letting personal events that would only matter to us, not letting that affect how a listener out there, you guys, would enjoy the film. So, for example, if I were to say that Spectre is the best Bond movie because I went to the film's London premiere and had a grand old time, that would be a ridiculous thing to say because that reasoning would not apply to you. At the end of this, we want a good definitive list for anyone to come in and watch it, okay? Now, this doesn't mean that we're looking to remove our personal emotions from our rankings entirely, because a great Bond movie should elicit emotions, like excitement or fear or humor or whatever. It just meant that those emotions had to be earned because the movie was doing something well, not because of personal extraneous circumstances of our life when we were watching the film. Our 5 private rankings that we all individually came up with, we did not share them with each other, were all sent in to our genius friend, Brian Fnifter. Thank you, Brian, who did some math wizardry to come up with our initial group average, okay? Again, none of us have any idea what our collective average is going to be until Athena here reads them off one by one. We'll discuss each film as it comes up in our rankings. So we're going to discuss these films not in chronological order like most people discuss these films, but by ranking, starting with the worst and going up to the best. We'll give our quick thoughts on the film and reveal where we each privately ranked each movie, and then we move to our group's number 24 pick and then so on. Now, we do have the option to change our minds, which is great because I think Bond fans, we're always changing our minds, and a year from now, I'm going to listen to this and be like, what was I thinking, right? So after listening to each other's debate, we can decide at any time to change our rankings of any film, okay? So after we've covered all 25 films, we'll then re-average our rankings to come up with our ultimate and final group average, okay? This is going to be the ultimate list. So if you're new to the Bond series and you want to avoid spoilers or you just want to get a quick look at what this ultimate list is, look down in the description of this podcast or this video and you will see a time code and just jump right there and you'll get the lowdown on what you should watch. I think maybe one thing we should mention here, I don't know about you guys, but I generally, even the ones that are way down my list, I still love the Bond movies. Like, even though there's going to be, there's one that I don't like, but there's 24 of them that I think are fun movies. Any given day, I will happily watch them. We're not here to rag on the series.
Yeah,
we're here to celebrate the series.
I don't hate any of them.
There are a number of great things in every Bond film.
So, I think we're ready to go. So, let's dig in. So, Athena, let's start with number 25. What did our group average say was the worst James Bond film of all time?
All right.
Well, as of 2017.
As of 2017, what do we think?
All right, so number 25 is about someone that you think that you can trust is just another way to die.
Quantum of Solace. All right. Okay.
Really?
All right.
Wow. I'm not shocked.
Bob, why don't you start with what ranking you gave and kind of just your quick thoughts on why you gave it that ranking.
Quantum of Solace. I rated this not number 25, but number 24.
Ooh, close. Wow. Okay.
Reason I do not like this movie.
What's going there?
I have to go there because it's number 24.
Yeah.
One of the shortest runtimes a Bond movie has.
Mercilessly short.
But feels long.
Mm.
Too many action fonts announcing locations. That is very distracting. You know?
It's the only movie I think it does that in the series. Yeah.
Yes. The only time we have a main Bond girl that Bond does not sleep with, which I think is blasphemy. Weakest Bond villain of all time. The guy can't even swing an axe with conviction. There's terrible editing. Action scenes do not make sense. They are incomprehensible. Ditto for most of the plot. The Quantum organization seems like a very cool, you know, pseudo-Spectre thing for Bond to fight, but they are not really followed up on in any great way.
Okay.
That is also frustrating.
I mean, in the series, like later in the series,
sure. And even within the film, it feels like they're set up neat, and then it just kind of boils away into this water plot that also seems very, like, it seems almost pedestrian for a Bond film.
Sure.
Nice connections back to Casino Royale with Mathis and Mr. White and all that. Those are nice. The Coda scene, which I know goes back to the Vesper thing, interesting, but it almost feels like it comes out of a different movie.
Okay.
A better movie. Feels like they are going back to the Bond going rogue plot a little too much by now. Yeah. It's just, I've just always viewed it as messy, badly edited, badly directed movie. The only thing I really like about it, beyond Daniel Craig's performance, would be the score by David Arnold, and even the title tune is very lackluster.
Brutal. Okay, Ryan.
Well, I actually ranked it 19, so I liked it a little more than you did. So I'll actually talk about the things I liked.
Okay.
I like the opening. I think the opening is a good. I think it's a strong opening. I think Craig is even more comfortable this time around than he is in Casino Royale. I like that. I think the action scenes are strong. There are more of them than in almost any Bond film. But to talk about things I don't like, I hate the editing of the film. The film was made, I think, because of the Bourne franchise. And I have a real problem with that. I'm not a fan of cut editing and not following the action well.
Yeah, yeah.
I like smooth filmmaking.
And that's the style that most Bond movies follow.
Yeah.
Is the smooth style.
And I would have preferred that. The script is rushed. It felt like it was never really cohesive. I had a real problem with that. The thing I wish there was more of, I love Mathis.
Yeah.
And I love him in Casino Royale.
Yep.
And I wanted more of him. Mm-hmm. You know, his death scene's actually pretty good in terms of the way Bond handles it. I kind of like that. But
with the dumpster?
Yeah, yeah. I think that's a Bond moment. Okay. I really think that's sort of a Bond moment. And I love the opera scene. I think the opera scene is gorgeous. I think it's really well done. I think Craig is really strong in that scene. Yeah,
for listeners out there, Bob is covering his hands in disgust. Covering his face with his hands.
I like the opera sequence. I think Craig's actually really good in the opera sequence. I have a real problem with the villain. I really like the actor. He had done a great movie beforehand.
Diving Bell and the Butterfly.
I think a wonderful film, and he's a good actor that's not used well. Yeah. Which happens in movies. Sometimes.
Which happens in a lot of Bond movies, where a lot of times you'll find people were cast because of some movie they did before.
Yeah.
And sometimes it works out, and sometimes you're like, I see.
It doesn't.
You watch that other movie, and you're like, oh, that's why they got hired. But then you watch the Bond movie, and just something isn't quite there, which I'm sure we'll get to.
Yeah, it doesn't work here.
Cool. John.
Robert Carlyle.
Yeah, I was about to say.
Yeah. That is true.
Yeah. Christoph Waltz.
Yeah.
Yes, unfortunately. Yeah. What a heartbreaker that was.
Spoilers.
I ranked it 23, so it's down there. I think what saves it from being
dead
at the
last
bottom for me is I think Daniel Craig is great.
Okay.
I love the fight scene in the hotel room. I think is great. Like you, I like the Mathis scenes. And I kind of like the locations. I feel like it's sort of fresh and Bondian. The editing ruins the movie for me. The villain's flat. The Bond girl's flat. The villain's plan is non-existent. I mean, it's just, all the other elements are terrible. And as far as being engaged in it as an actual movie, it's a strain to get to the end of that movie. You really don't care. So, everything kills it, but Craig is fabulous. And, it has some moments.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
And Athena.
Okay, so.
Where did you rank it?
This was number 22 for me. And I have to agree with a lot of what was said. I agree with Bob that the villain is pretty flat and his plan is maybe too realistic and boring.
It's water bills, basically. It's really what it is.
The main Bond girl is also flat and boring. the editing is terrible. I do like Strawberry Fields, even though she only is in the movie for a very short period of time.
Like
Jenna Arterton?
Yeah, her death sequence, even though it's a copycat of another movie, I am amused by it.
Mm.
The fight sequence where they crash down through the window.
Yeah.
That, I think, is really amazing. But, again, the editing could be better with that in the entire movie. Opera scene. So pretty and beautiful. I love the editing of that particular one because you're cutting from the opera to the fight, and it's just that I could watch that and be really happy.
Bob is having an aneurysm over here.
I'm going to add a note at the end of this to explain this.
Okay.
But yeah, I mean, I also don't like how connected to Casino Royale it is. I do feel like it's too connected to the movie, and I want my Bond films to be separate.
Mm. Okay, interesting.
It's interesting. The style of the opera scene divides people.
Right.
I like it okay, but I love the idea of the opera scene, that Bond finds himself a perch and then communicates through the headsets of all the bad guys and watches each and every person.
Yeah, that's cool. That's a good moment.
I think that's a perfect way for him.
Where
to
do you think you're going? I like
each,
that.
Each
I
and
like
everyone,
that
except for the one villain who's smart enough to stay seated.
Yeah.
I think that is a really cool Bondian thing.
I will give you that. That is a great moment. When I refer to the opera scene, it's a different part. But that part, I agree. Yeah. That gives it like a half point.
So Bob, just I'll get my thoughts in a bit. But obviously you're a little enraged about this. So what about the opera scene do you not like?
Okay, another note I should have added of why I don't like this movie. Director trying too hard to be artistic.
Yes,
And it's really evident in two sequences.
Yep.
In the opening, the first chase over the rooftops, we have cross-cut with a matador.
We're always cutting back, and there's no reason to cut back beyond flavor.
He's purely trying to parallel, chase here, chase there. And I'm like, nope, I don't care. Yep. I want to follow the foot chase. I don't care about the bull chase. Second time he does it is at the opera, and he's doing this whole thing where Bond is escaping and shooting and beating up people.
But that part's
amazing. Opera, and it's supposed to be so arty and wonderful and operatic, pretentious and boring. I just wanted to punch him. I just wanted to punch the director.
Well, Bob, you'll be happy to know my nickname for Quantum of Solace is Quantum of Suckass.
Yep.
So.
Yep. All right. I gave this movie a 20th ranking. I think we were the top two.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I kind of look at this movie as a brave experiment. Maybe a failed experiment, but a brave experiment. Here's what I liked. I think the best – I agree. As a car guy especially, the first 2 minutes are awesome. Maybe the best – opening 2 minutes of any of the movies. It just drops you right into like one of the most thrilling car chases ever filmed. It's just awesome. I like the quiet scenes are nice in this movie too. There's not enough of them, but the quiet scenes with Mathis, and we finally get to see James Bond drunk. I believe this is the first movie where we get to see James Bond visibly drunk. Yeah. Which happens in
really drunk.
Yeah, and he's really like, drunk.
How many does he have? Six or seven?
Yeah,
he has
like
a lot.
Way too many. And yeah. And in the books, he's always getting drunk. And this seems to be the only time where we finally see one of his major vices, which is drinking. Right. I think the action sequences are exciting in concept, but they're not well filmed or edited. And by what I mean by that is that he's always outgunned or outnumbered. He's outnumbered in the car chase and doesn't even have a door to protect himself. He's outgunned in the boat sequence. He has an old plane versus a new plane and a helicopter in the plane sequence. And David Zarnell's score is really good with his action. It's frenetic and crazy and it's just really great. I like how it's a mercilessly short runtime, 90 minutes, which is really short. Is this still the shortest Bond movie? I think it might be. It's between this or Goldfinger. They're both like really, really short.
That's a plus for the
film. Yeah, for this movie, that's it. I like how Bond is immaculately tailored, which is a problem for later Daniel Craig movies. And I like his cardigan. And on the negative, though, it's the villains that kill it for me. The weakest villain and the weakest villain's henchman with Elvis and the most boring bad guy plot of the entire series. And it's lame having Bond fight Green at the end when there's like, come on, Bond is badass. He's going to just, you know, why is this even a scene? Like, there's no suspense to it. We know what's going to happen. And yeah, some of the action sequences are nearly incomprehensible. So that's our number 25th pick. So I think we can open to debates.
Okay.
There was a henchman in this movie?
Yeah, Elvis, barely.
And his pants blow off.
My God.
Yes, it's true.
I know you've told me this. Oh my God.
I like Judy Dench in it. Nobody said that. I think she's really good in it. I've enjoyed Judi Dench since GoldenEye, and I think she has really good stuff in this.
Yeah.
She gets mad and is throwing things, and I like her a lot.
She's very human in this one.
Yeah, and I think that's leads up to other things.
As to Elvis, feel like it truly was, and it was, an unfinished script. They had to rush
it. Yes, the writer's strike. Yeah.
And I watch the movie now, and I see, I think I know what they're doing with Elvis, that you don't get it all. He's sort of the comic relief. He's a joke henchman. First of all, his name's Elvis. Yeah. And you see, every moment he gets to shine, to be a henchman, he gets tripped, or something goes wrong.
Or his pants blow off.
Or at the end, his pants blow off. Yep. So I think the whole joke of Elvis was he's the henchman that never gets...
To be a badass henchman.
Yeah, his hand on Bond. He's just the hapless henchman. You kind of see it in the movie, but it doesn't play in the movie at all.
Right.
But I think it's there. And I think that's why you think, what was the story with that henchman?
Right.
The joke never landed ever.
Right.
It just seems
it was a couple drafts away or something from getting there.
So I think that's what was up with him. I think it was the idea of him.
Right, right.
Someone else had mentioned Bond going rogue.
Yeah.
I am done with that.
Boy, I'm done with that.
I have no interest in seeing another Bond film.
I was done with that after License to Kill.
Yeah. Yep.
And he did it a lot after that.
Yep.
Is he never not? He's always rogue.
I want a straight mission. Personal.
It feels like in almost all the Craigs in some fashion he's rogue.
Yeah, he's rogue. Yeah, he spends most of his time not working under orders. He's doing his own thing. Yeah, that's true.
It's a shame.
Okay. All right, let's move on to number 24.
So, number 24. Is I guess I'll die another day.
I guess this isn't not a huge shocker.
Not a shock.
No, not a
shock. All right, Ryan, if you could start us off.
So this is rank 24. Okay. I ranked Die Another Day 22. I saw
Let it out.
That's why we're here.
There's stuff to like about this movie. The first third of the movie, like a couple of other Bond films, I actually think works pretty well. He's investigating. Yeah. He's going to exotic locations. I like that part of it. There's multiple endings in this movie, which drives me insane. It happens in a couple of Bond films. The music is good. I don't like Madonna's theme at all. But boy, yeah. Oh, and I hate the ending. I think the plane sequence is ridiculous. You look at Brosnan when he's kite surfing or whatever that he's doing, and you know he's thinking in his head, "What is going on?" And this is my fourth film. The diamonds in the face stuff. I can't stand any of that. This script is kind of sloppy. When they get to the ice headquarters or whatever the hell it is, I think the movie just falls apart stylistically. Written, I don't think it's written as well. And the villain, I get he's kind of being Bond, But Bond films are as good as the villains, I think. And I never found him remotely interesting. I think he's a good actor.
Yeah.
And Halle Berry, in a way, she's kind of underused. She had just won her Oscar.
Please, I don't need any more of her in that movie.
yeah, right? Yeah, I got plenty.
Well, I think Halle is better than the movie.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't think a standalone film would have helped her character, but...
the Jinx movie.
Yeah, I like Halle Berry, but I don't particularly like her in this. My 22 won't change, I don't think, right. by what anyone cool. says, so that's me.
And John, from a screenwriter's perspective, this movie was the only one written by Purvis and Wade without someone else.
Solo.
Is that right?
Yeah, it's the only one that they, as far as I know, that they did complete by themselves.
Yeah, it was just them. Yeah.
And they've never written another, as far as I know, another screenplay. Again, they do the treatments, but they have now.
They break the story. This is the only one where it was...
They do some rewriting, but they actually come in. This one, you know, and there's a lot about it. I mean, the dialogue is horrendous in this movie. But I should start by saying...
Yeah. What do you think?
21.
21, okay.
And there's stuff in this movie that I like. It's actually my second favorite Brosnan movie.
Okay.
I think Brosnan's pretty good in it. The dialogue kind of drives me crazy, but I really like the movie up till the Ice Palace. I love Cuba. I love the opening. I love the fact that we have extended action in London. And I think it unravels structurally in the Ice Palace sequence, even though I like the idea of Bond going to Iceland in Ice Palace. That tidal wave that he surfs on, I think it's horrible because the special effect is horrible, but I think it has a worse crime in that it takes all the energy away from the ice chase.
Yeah.
That's the big action sequence. Right. After you surf a tidal wave, action sequence over. You can't then go have a car chase, and it really hurts that. Yeah. So I think the movie structurally unravels in there. But then I sort of like the end. I like the airplane stuff. So I sort of am okay with Die Another Day as an attempt to do a big scale, fantastic Bond movie. I think it's better than The World Is Not Enough. So, but I don't love it, obviously. It's at 21. But I'd say the strength are locations. That's about it.
Okay. Arthena, what are your thoughts?
Okay. Dino of the Day is number 16 for me.
Okay.
Oh.
There's a lot.
Let's hear this. All right.
There's a lot that I like about it, but the dislikes are so heavy that that it's not the best film for me. So I really do like Miranda Frost. I think she's a great character.
She is. I do like Miranda Frost.
She is underused.
Yeah. She is underused. Yeah, that's true. And the other Bond girl, Jinx, I think she's terrible. writing is bad. Character is bad. I really wish she was just not part of this movie at all. I love the gadget that Bond has of the ring that basically, what is it, a pulse?
Yeah. The ring, that's cool.
I think that the gene therapy is interesting. It's a little over the top. Terrible CGI, terrible writing. I don't mind all of the references to past films since this was an anniversary film. You know, the diamonds, yes, we've seen
the,
it.
The key scene where we see
it. That doesn't take it down for me because that was part of the point of the film. But yes, Sal's expensive acne, I'm just like, hello, you can pluck that out.
Yeah, why did you leave the diamonds in his
like, why are you keeping that face. In your face? I love the gigantic Ice Palace set. I think it's amazing. And I like when Bond movies go a little over the top like that.
Okay, cool. I rank this number 24. I kind of look at this movie like on paper, it's great. It's like a dish created by a good cook. But with awful ingredients. That's how I look at it. So I think we'll see a lot of movies like this, but I agree with you guys. It's a solid first half where the last half lets it down. And I feel like that's a common problem with a lot of the worst Bond movies. I love the sword fight at Blades.
Oh, I forgot to say that. Yeah. I freaking love that sword
fight.
That
scene is great.
That is amazing.
Yep. In fact, I think it's the best scene in the movie. There's a nice twist with the villains and who the true identities are. And I think we forget about that because we've probably all seen the movie a million times. But the first time you see the movie, that's an effective twist. You do not see that coming. Mm-hmm. And when it plays, you're like, at least I did. And the audiences I saw it with were like, that's who, that's the bad guy. You know, and at least it's energetic. Like, everyone is trying hard to make a good film. No one's mailing it in. It's just everyone's just doing the wrong things and just, you know, it's a hot mess. Yeah. I would put it
a
in.
Hot
it's
mess.
On the negatives, Madonna's title song is one of the worst of the series. The cartoon is CGI and the dated speed. I also work as an editor, so the speed ramping, the editing that happens about 5 or 6 times where the shots kind of like speed up and then go slow motion. Yeah. It's this weird MTV editing that does not fit into Bond movies, which to me are very classically edited or should be. Groan-inducing puns. Oh my god, throughout. Also, Halle Berry, never been worse. Brosnan feels awkwardly out of place in this one. He's acting serious and dramatic in what's actually a very silly film. This is not like Roger Moore in Moonraker. Roger Moore knows he's in a silly film and he embraces it. You actually kind of feel embarrassed for Brosnan in this one, I feel like. And the tone is all over the place. At parts it's dark and serious, like the first half, and other times it's so over the top and outrageous. It just never really gels. Bob, what are your thoughts?
I mean, I'm generally with most of you guys. For me, Die Another Day is number 23.
Wow.
So I'm very close to the ranking there.
So Athena, it looks like your ranking of 16 is solely what saved this from the bottom of the heap.
I like Sir Brosnan.
Yeah,
I like
that's
Sir
fine.
Brosnan. Yeah. I feel like it started lower for me, and then as I kept adding things I loved, it went up.
Yeah, it's kind of a charming heart mess.
But
so
yeah,
Bob,
what
did you think?
So I call this the kitchen sink Bond film.
Mm-hmm. Everything.
Everything to excess. It's the 40th anniversary, the 20th Bond film, but yet, you know, we're getting 1 minute some nice nods like the big gadget room with Q, and yeah, I liked seeing that. And the rip-off Diamonds Are Forever villain plot with the satellite and all that, but then you get the, as you say, the Ice Palace and invisible cars and... Oh my god, it's just it's like too much. Even the end, with the plane going through a laser beam, but everyone's so like okay,
it's not a laser beam, it's a reflected sun
or whatever.
Reflected sunbeam, Bob.
Yeah, reflected sunbeam. And then
it's different from Diamonds Are Forever.
Oh, we get a Goldfinger laser scene but with like multiple lasers.
Oh, that's the most ridiculous.
Oh man, that's rough.
It's terrible. And then, we even get a Living Daylights thing with the thing coming out of the back of a plane, but it's a helicopter, but it's going to start midair, and I'm like, "Oh my god."
Yeah.
Anyway, sorry.
So those things didn't come off as references to you, more like weird ripoffs or something.
Yeah, as I said, I like some bits. Like, as I said, the gadget room was cool.
Yeah.
I love the idea of James Bond being captured and tortured and brainwashed. I really do. I'm a big fan of The Man with the Golden Gun book. That's kind of from that. The one time I ever tried to write a Bond spec, I actually used that plot device. I was like, oh, they're going to do it. Yay. And it's wasted. It's completely wasted, this movie. So he gets captured and we have Brosnan acting very serious and tortured at first, and then we realize no, he's in a very lighthearted, goofy James Bond movie, and so we have a tonality problem there that's really horrible. Halle Berry seems like she was given a license to ham it up and deliver a bad performance, because I know she's a good actress.
But I think it was the, if I may, I think it was the script. I mean, look at the terrible lines. Like,
I don't think it's her.
What was the line? Like your mother called, and she said she's upset.
Her dialogue is the worst of any of the characters in that movie.
I think she was given garbage dialogue, and even an Academy Award winning actress can't make that come up. Yeah,
I agree. David Arnold, for once, turns in a score that, while okay, it's kind of overcooked. It's a little too over-technified for me. The worst theme song ever of all time by Madonna. It's not. It's barely even music. I don't even know what to call it. I do love the villain once he as you say, the twist. Toby Stevens?
Yeah.
Yes. I actually really liked him as a villain. I thought he was super smarmy and he seemed like a threat. And I like the confrontation with Bond. The sword fight is the highlight. Whenever I think of Die Another Day, I just want to watch the sword fight.
Yep.
It's one of the few scenes where they feel like there's real stakes and it's personal.
Yeah.
And
Bond could get hurt. And
How long do we have to wait for a sword fight in a Bond movie?
Yeah. Right.
A little moment.
Wow, you're right.
Yeah.
Like, finally,
an actual
Bond
sword fight.
Took this long.
Yeah.
I love how it starts out like really playful and they get really pissed and aggressive at each other.
The way that it builds.
I think is really good.
Absolutely. So the sword fight keeps it from getting down to 25. I too like Miranda Frost. I find her rather fetching. But beyond that, I do think the character is interesting.
Yep. Okay.
Although her sleeping with Bond's a little shoehorned in, but we've had worse.
Yeah,
you know, whatever.
We've had much worse.
You made a very good point. We have another line. We have another in a long line of cosmetically interesting but non-threatening henchmen. That I feel like is a staple of the Brosnan era. They're not as cool as Oddjob or Jaws. They're just these guys that I'm albino or
what? Mr. Kill doesn't do it for you?
Yeah, God, oh, jeez, no.
All right, any debate on this one, guys? Are we all kind of agreeing?
There's dialogue. There's some good dialogue between Bond and M when he's kind of come back and they got him in the
jail, little bit of that subplot that
where they kind of talk about, you know, you had your suicide pill 3 years ago.
Yeah.
That's a throwaway line, but I think that's a really strong line that, you know, he's been doing this for a while now. Again, I'll bring up M a couple of times. I think her moments are really some of the better moments of all the films she's in.
Yeah.
Okay. I think she
I've never been a big M as Judi Dench fan.
Oh.
I'm a fan of Judi Dench. I think just her having to have a subplot in every movie.
Yeah.
Continuing that.
Oh, I'll get into that later.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, cool. I would agree with that.
But then just when I thought I had enough M, I love Skyfall. So suddenly it's like, okay, but M done in the right way, I'm fine with her. And Judi Dench is a great actress.
Yeah, yeah.
But it felt like they had to give her a full storyline in every recent movie, and I was tired of it.
Right.
Okay.
Felt like the villain was also like a weird, warped, dark, mirror universe version of James Bond.
Sure.
Too. Yeah.
And I thought that was kind of an interesting take for a Bond film. Yeah. Or a Bond villain, anyway. Yeah.
I'm not a fan of villains that are younger than Bond or Bond's age, though.
Interesting.
I like the father figure, too.
Yeah, I like the father figure. The corrupt father figure that he brings down. Not the younger man.
Who it's been the younger man for a while.
I know. It's, right? Well, I think it's a little bit of a flaw in the classic structure.
I agree.
Okay. All right. I think we can move on to our 23rd worst, or let's just say it's the 23rd ranking.
Yeah.
It's the 23rd best.
We should say
23rd best. Let's be positive, right? Okay. All right. And Athena, what is our number 23 group average pick?
Okay. Number 23 is Meeting You with a View to a Kill.
Okay. All right.
Yep.
Bang, boom.
23. John, you will lead us in this one.
Okay. If you could. I ranked it as 20.
Okay.
What do I like about A View to a Kill? I guess I like Max Zorn. I like the villain. I like Christopher Walken.
Yeah.
It's just unfortunate. I'm a big Octopussy fan. Yeah. Okay. And they did try to continue that kind of, it's not camp, but it's sort of burlesque. And they nail it in Octopussy.
Burlesque.
View to a Kill. View to a Kill. Like, they go too far.
Okay.
And so tonally, it's rough. I still sort of enjoy it because it's such a Bond film of the 80s.
It's a classic Bond movie.
It's a classic Bond movie, and something you'll find if you go to conventions and stuff, a lot of people will dress up in costumes from A View to a Kill. So it sort of is a classic in its own way. But when you break it down into the elements, I mean, nothing really is all that great.
Okay.
Okay. So, you know, 20.
Okay. Athena.
All right. So this is, you know, middle of the road for me. I have it as number 15.
Okay.
It needs more power.
more power.
More power. So, I mean, I like Grace Jones as a henchwoman. That's, I think, the best thing about the movie.
Yeah.
And I like the fight on the airship. I like the car cut in half.
That's fine.
That made no sense to me. Good. How did that even...
Anyway. It's a front-wheel drive car.
All right.
It could work.
Whatever.
I really love the cheesy title song opening.
Duran Duran?
Yeah. I mean, it's the visuals are cheesy. It's that, you know, the day glow.
Yeah, the day glow paint. The 80s day glow. Sure.
But I probably just more have reactions to what everyone else is saying. This is a middle of the road
movie for me. I rated this number 21. For me, this movie is all about the bad guys. They steal the show. Christopher Walken and Grace Jones are terrific villains with an awesome blimp. The music is great. I love the Duran Duran title theme, and just throughout, the music is just very exciting. There's a few exceptionally shot sequences that are they're over too quickly, like the car wash kill, like the horse race with Zorn and Bond, the Eiffel Tower chase, but they're too short. You know what I mean? There's little flashes of brilliance throughout. It's kind of a comfort food for classic Bond fans, but the problem is it's kind of warmed over comfort food, you know?
Reheated.
Poor Roger Moore. He is so old in this one. And it makes his comments to the young ladies creepy. I mean, unlike Octopussy, where Maude Adams is kind of a mature, you know, they keep on putting him, he's so old, and they keep on putting him with these really young girls that don't know how to act, and it just doesn't come off right. It doesn't help that they cast him as old and that he's wearing these really staid jackets and suits, and Bond is driving a gray LTD and he bakes a quiche. I mean, he's doing old man stuff, so it doesn't really help his case, you know,
on the porch with a shotgun. Let's play to his old manness. No, not if you're gonna put him in a shower with a 21-year-old.
Yeah, it's really strange. There's this weird mix of tone with the 80s violence, which they were trying to ramp up more, but then also these more era silliness of like the Keystone Cops and the Beach Boys music in the middle of that chase scene. And there's a boring middle. There's too much explanation of Zorn's legal work, but I just fall asleep every time in the middle of this movie. Tanya Roberts, Bond girl, she's very attractive, but let's face it, she's just kind of a screaming bimbo in this one and isn't given much to really do. She's not my favorite Bond girl. That's what I say about that. Bob?
I voted it number 22. Fantastic title tune by Duran Duran.
Yes.
Easily the highest point of the movie gives you.
Okay.
John Barry does deliver a good score. He doesn't really ever do a bad score. That's about where my compliments end. The plot is a retread of Goldfinger.
Yeah.
Silicon Valley.
Yep.
Christopher Walken. I love the idea of casting him as a Bond villain, but I feel, I don't know if he wasn't ready yet.
Is it the young thing that John was talking about earlier?
Maybe? I don't think it's even the young thing. He is idiosyncratic, but not in a way I find terribly threatening.
Except, he isn't threatening.
Except for the part where he mows down all those miners, and even that's weird. It just feels weirdly violent for a Bond movie.
Yeah.
Grace Jones, again, odd stunt casting. I mean, okay, she's memorable because she looks so weird, but her and Zorn hooking up.
I like, that's awesome. I love her arc, too.
I know. And her arc comes out of nowhere. It's about as convincing to me as, like, the turnabout in...
They killed Jenny Flex. Remember? Jenny Flex, that really memorable character.
Can I also just say Jenny Flex, great name, wasted on not really a Bond girl.
Sure.
Yes, my brother used to always go, that was the one with Jenny Flex. I'm like, you just like the name. U.S. locations make it feel a little pedestrian. Stacey Sutton is pretty much a hapless bimbo in distress. She's nice to look at, but oh my god, screams so much.
James!
Kills me every time. I love this. I actually love Bond skiing. I'm cool with him snowboarding until the Beach Boys music comes.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It ruined these attempts at laughs. Yeah. Just are just so cheesy and out of place.
Very cheesy. Yes, God, Roger Moore, I love you, but... You are too old to be playing James Bond in this one. He just looks too old. And weirdly, this is one of the few films he hooks up with four women.
Four?
Yes, four women. Shall I count them for you?
Yes, the submarine.
Hot babe in the submarine.
Yeah.
Random Russian spy jacuzzi hookup.
Yeah, that's right.
Out of nowhere. I don't even know what that was all about.
Oh, yeah. Bubbles.
I like that.
Yeah, the bubbles. Mike Jacowski.
Obviously, Stacey Sutton in the end in the shower. Yeah, that whole scene made me go, like, did I miss a Bond film or this?
I like that idea that he meets up with an old Russian ally.
Yeah.
You almost could think that that's XXX from Spy Who Loved Me. Wouldn't that have been interesting? Yeah,
That would have been cool.
What a missed opportunity to have Barbara Bach in there. I didn't even think about that. Yeah.
And number four was Grace Jones when he has to hold his cover and he's like, I was waiting for you. And she's like, right. and then Zorn sends her in. It's like, wow.
And all these girls.
He's perfectly okay with it, too. Wow.
And all these women are probably 25 or younger.
Probably.
I think Roger was 55. Yeah.
Hey, he's
like
fine wine.
He's a little sure. Warmed over.
I will also say it's great seeing Patrick McNee being an Avengers fan.
There you go.
Teaming up James Bond, even though, again, kind of wasted. Wish he had done more. I will say this. I do kind of like the Eiffel Tower escape sequence.
Yeah.
I'm a sucker for the tasty assassin sequences in Bond movies.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a cool location. We get a cool aerial scene in Bond. Yeah. So, all right. There's another compliment for the movie.
There you go.
It still doesn't go above 22.
Gotcha. Yeah.
I do like I should like the Golden Gate Bridge at the end and how it's cut together. I think it really effectively cuts together studio stuff and real stuff shot in it.
I think the back projection that's used throughout this movie is kind of ruins it for me. There's a lot of it and none of it looks good. It takes me out of the movie. I never believe that Roger Moore is hanging from the tower because it's obviously a back projection. So, Ryan...
Well, I ranked at 25.
Whoa, dead last. Woo! Is this the first 25 we've heard?
I think it is. Wow. I think it is. I still like the movie. I really do. I think the opening sequence is fun. They hadn't done snowboarding in movies all that often. This was one of the first movies to do that. Yep. So that's pretty cool. Sir Godfrey, I like that. I like that they're working together. And the title song, I think, is great. The problem is, whenever you see Roger in an action sequence, anytime he's not facing the camera, it's obviously not him.
Yeah.
And the fight scene in Stacy's home is atrocious. It's just a horrible fight scene. And
what's so bad about it?
Well, because the way he's moving around is clearly... It feels like an older man than him.
Yeah.
And then he's on the ground at one point, and he gets up, and he kind of shuffles to the door to try to go after them. It's laughably bad.
Okay.
I think he's fine outside of action sequences. I think he's atrocious in action sequences.
Okay.
And he's not that way in Octopussy. I think Christopher Walken is incredibly underused. I like him as an actor. He has He has a few moments that are really great. I just don't, and I think Mayday's bizarre. I don't think she belongs in the movie at all. When he rolls his eyes when he's having sex with her, I was just, again, it's the showing of his age throughout the entire film. I kind of have a problem with that, but I don't like the San Francisco sequence at all. Yeah. I think it's a waste. It belongs in another movie. You know, he's having a good time. There's no real peril in it. And the good guys are chasing the good guys, which always seems kind of weird to me.
Yeah.
The fire at City Hall, that's actually pretty cool. I mean, that's a legitimate fire of a well-known building. So I think that's actually kind of awesome. And the movie goes to a lot of locations. So, you know, he's traveling around and that's exciting. But I love Roger. I really do. I think this is a tough movie to like. So,
yeah.
Any debates here?
I remember being excited about being able to buy some stuff at the Sharper Image at the time it came out.
Like what? What'd you get?
I remember it had good promotional stuff.
It did good promotional stuff.
What kind of stuff they had?
Well, you get a copy of the card he uses to get into Stacy's place. Oh. And I believe they did sell that robot dog thing.
What?
Had. Yeah.
The Q dog?
Yeah, the Q dog.
So 80s.
You know, I actually saw the premiere. I went to the world premiere in San Francisco of this.
Yeah.
And in the beginning, the skiing and the snow and everything, people were cheering and clapping when he surfed down.
Yeah.
You couldn't hear the Beach Boys song. Oh. So I never heard the Beach Boys song until I watched it again. And I came out of the premiere saying that opening was fantastic. Mm. And then I saw it again and realized they ruined this great thing with this Beach Boys song. But just visually, it was a perfect end to that.
Right. Okay. All right. I think we can move on to our 22nd ranking. All Athena, can you do the honors?
22nd. Number 22 is about an assassin, the second to none, the man with the golden gun.
That's what I expected.
Yes. So Athena, let's have you start this one.
Okay. Well, I think other movies do it better. James Bond is a dick. Throughout the entire movie.
To everyone.
To everybody.
Yeah.
The Golden Gun, that's cool. I do like how it's different pieces and it puts together. The fun house at the end, I do like that, even though it's very strange. I do really like Goodnight. She's very kind of inexperienced, and I don't know, she reminds me of a Doctor Who companion, which just, I like that.
Do you like her because she's kind of someone who... because I feel like there's a lot of Bond movies where the Bond girl is like, you know, they try to make her like Bond's equal. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And do you like the idea that this is someone who, like, they don't even try. They just show her like she's a rookie.
Yeah. It seems like he's kind of training her, but he's also a dick to her through the entire movie. The worst part of this movie, I cannot stand J.W. Pepper, Sheriff. I can't stand him. He ruins the good parts of the movie for me. Number 21 for me.
Okay.
On The Man with the Golden Gun.
All right. This is dead last for me. This is the only Bond movie that I straight up do not like. If it is on TV, I will turn it off. I just do not like this film. All right. There's a couple things I like. Christopher Lee and Knick Knack, they're memorable. They're barely in it. But at least they're memorable. There's some exotic locations that I quite like. I also agree with the thing. I like the Scaramanga's kind of horror house, and the tilting ship set is cool. And the way that Scaramanga's gun, you know, can get some like bits and bobs is kind of neat. But it's unfunny slapstick, just run amok. It's everything, anything for a laugh. And like Athena said, our gentleman spy, he's a dick to everyone, even poor kids and wannabe lovers. He stuffs, you know, poor Goodnight into a closet, has sex with Maude Adams, and then in the morning, he doesn't even really apologize. He's just like, you'll have your turn. It's like, oh my gosh. It's just, this movie is just not suited to Roger Moore's strengths. It just, it does not use him correctly. Roger Moore, by his own admission, is a lover and not a fighter, and he's definitely not a slapper. I mean, this is 1974, and he's slapping information out of the woman. It's like, man, in the 60s, it's really questionable. Man, by 74... Oof,
it does feel like this was written for Connery.
Yes, if this was Connery, I think he could have maybe gotten away with it. Because I don't know, Connery somehow had that kind of edge to him, and Roger just—it doesn't feel right.
Even Roger hated that moment. It was something that didn't work for him. But they were still feeling out what kind of Bond he was.
It's just the whole film feels kind of cheap and tired and lazy and mean. And I think you could see this is the movie where Harry Saltzman and Cubby Broccoli were splitting up, the producers of the movie, And I think you can kind of sense that everyone is kind of just barely there, just kind of getting a paycheck.
It was a rush.
It was a rush. Yeah, and I feel like that all those behind the scenes drama, I think, unfortunately, are very obvious with this movie.
And a ton of script revisions.
Yep.
Quantum of Solace in this movie. It was very quickly done.
It's the mistake of the number two movies. A lot of the number two movies suffered from being rushed.
Yeah.
And not being fully
rehearsed. Yeah, yeah. Bob, what did you think? A Man with Golden Gun.
So I guess I'm going to get in Athena's camp on this one. I mean, when I say that, I mean bucking the trend. I rate it number 15. So look.
That's 10 spots too high,
Bob. Don't misunderstand me. I know the film has faults, okay? I'm not at all saying this is like a great Mon movie. I'll say it. Weak title tune by Lulu.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know? Yeah, not the best.
Not the best. Not the worst, but not the best. I do like John Barry's score. There's a lot of stuff. It kind of grows on you, but every time I listen to it, there's some great tracks where he's searching with the plane for Scaraman in his island. Yeah. Great bit of score right there. Roger Moore, they play him too harsh here. Yeah, slapping the information out, I agree, not his strength. Christopher Lee is fantastic at Scaramanga. Nick Knack is weird, but...
He's memorable.
Memorable. All right, I'll give him that. Although the end fight with Nick Knack is a little
Again, it's like fighting. When he's fighting Green, it's like, gee, I wonder who's going to win this one.
Yeah, the women in this are gorgeous. We have Maude Adams and Britt Eklund, two lovely ladies. Although I have to say, very good night. Very badly written. Probably one of the most hapless, bumbling secret agents ever. Just to say, oh, women can't be good secret agents.
I like when she gets stuck in the trunk.
Oh God.
And I've got the Solex.
She's really trying hard.
She's trying, yeah.
I like Goodnight. She's one of them.
Okay,
but she is badly treated. The closet scene. Oh,
yeah.
Terrible. The sumo wrestling part, don't need it. there is a weird 70s kung fu borderline porn vibe in this movie. Because we almost get like a new chick swimming in the pool, and then we get like the kung fu school. Like it's totally shoehorned in. And it says we're gonna have a kung fu scene.
Because that's about kung fu in that.
We were talking about this earlier, John and Ryan. We were actually talking right before the podcast about how a lot of the Roger Moore movies are responses to some other popular movie like Live and Let Die's Blaxploitation, and this movie is kind of a response to like Enter the Dragon, the kind of kung fu craze, Spy Who Loved Me is kind of similar
to Jaws. It was a tie-in with
Jaws, right? And then obviously Moonraker to Star Wars. And I think to me it doesn't seem random. To me it makes sense in the film.
I get it in context of the day it was made,
sure,
but it's weird in a Bond movie.
Okay.
Oh, and I like Scaramanga's car plane. Oh, and there is a cool car flip jump that I think is pretty
impressive. Which is ruined by a bell whistle.
Totally not the stunt.
And amazing in a real stunt.
But look, on the whole, despite its issues, I generally do find it entertaining. I like the flow of it. I like the idea of a mano, you know, the golden bullet, and Bond has to go, you know, up again, the duel with Scaramanga. I love the dinner scene. When, you know,
they have dinner before their duel.
Totally. Yeah, I dig that. So there's all these other elements that tie it together enough that I kind of put it as a middling.
That's Bond what's movie. Missing in the new Bond movies, dinner scenes. Dinner there scenes and golf scenes.
There and, you go. And belly button bullets.
Oh my God. Can I just say, thank you for bringing that up.
Yeah.
The whole thing with him getting the golden bullet from the belly dancer and the, okay, fine. As a kid, I did not understand how he really... I thought, well, he swallowed it. He's screwed. I didn't understand that going to a pharmacy and basically had to, you know, how Bond had to really get the bullet to you. Yeah. I didn't get that as a kid.
I don't think any of us.
I think I just got it now.
Yeah, I think I just got it now. Well, okay.
There's pharmacy, right?
No, Bob, you gotta understand, I don't like this movie, so I don't think about it.
Oh, but there is that great scene where he's just, you know, speak now or forever hold your peace with the gun. I kind of like that.
I love that scene.
It just balances itself out. Yeah.
So exactly nearly middle 15.
There you go. That's me. I'm done.
Ryan.
I ranked it 24.
All right. Yeah, high five. All right. Yeah.
There you go.
What I like about it is I love Christopher Lee. I think he is excellent. I think you were mentioning that. I think the dinner sequence is great, that they're mano a mano, and he kind of talks about how they're how they're the same but opposite. They're just coming in from opposite sides. I like the Golden Bullet storyline. I don't like the Solex storyline. I think the Solex stuff is I get it's the product of the time.
Yeah.
So I understand that part of it. I think all of that's kind of weak. I love Maude Adams. I think she is gorgeous. I think she's great in this. Britt Eklund, you have an agent turned bimbo. We mentioned this at one point that apparently you put them in a bikini and they become idiots.
That
and,
is a common
and
problem.
That seems to be a problem in Bond films. So I like her at the beginning. The soul has, when she's locked in the trunk, I do kind of love that. I've got an idea with me. We're all good. Well, actually, you're not. That is exactly
you're flying
opposite
in
what
a
we
flying
want.
Car. Yeah.
M is also so mean to Q in that sequence. And when the sequence where they're updating Bond and what's going on, he just yells at him.
Everyone's
the entire
kind of dicks
scene.
To everyone.
They're all mean to each other.
Yeah.
And I have a real problem that M somehow finds Scaramanga's number at the very end of the movie. How did he find his number on the boat?
I've never thought about that.
Good call.
And it drives me nuts.
Wow.
You know he's... Yeah, I finally tracked you down. Well, how the hell did you find his number?
He's got a tracker. Remember Casino Royale? He's got it in his arm.
Okay. Yeah, I see. That's the thing. I knew you were going to say that, John. Who cares? I don't know. It's just a line of dialogue.
At that point, either you're with him or...
Yeah, right, right, yeah,
right,
yeah.
Right, it's
why
literally...
I love this movie until, oh, but... How did he get the number?
Yeah. Well, no. No, I don't love it. It's 24. Yeah, right. Well, who cares? He's It's fun. It's more being Connery.
Yeah.
Like it's more being Connery.
Yeah.
And I don't think he wants to be Connery. I think it was the way it was written.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's why he's fond of the next Bond film so much. Because it's his turn to take over the role.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's, you know, we can get into that movie later.
Yeah.
That was probably...
Hopefully much later.
The Golden Gun was Maybaum coming back and writing after Mankiewicz did.
Right. Yep.
Well,
they did
rewrites of rewrites of rewrites.
So
there's
it is
a lot
very much
stuff.
Someone who's used to writing Bond
in the Connery.
Role.
Yeah.
And they're
good
still
point.
Sure. But I ranked at 16. I'm very similar to Bob. There's nothing I dislike in the movie. It's a fine Bond movie. I think Roger looks really good in the movie. I love the locations. I think locations are terrific. I think it's a little small scale, and that always bothered me. But the things that you guys don't like, I like. I love Goodnight. I love their relationship. I love that Bond sort of picks on her the whole movie. She's trying to be a good agent, and Bond just sort of makes it hard on her. And it cracks me up. I think Knick-Knack is great. I love that he's sort of a manipulator.
He's mischievous.
And there's a moment that it's like, wow, they never brought that back. Is when Bond is stalking Scaramanga and he comes upon Knick-Knack. And Knick-Knack says, if you kill him, all this is mine.
Mm.
And he wants to show him the idea of the henchman sort of turning and helping Bond because I want you to kill him because then I take it. I kind of dig that.
Yeah, okay.
And then his little turn in the end. So I think he's a neat little presence who comes throughout the movie and always is kind of tripping up Bond. You kind of never know where he stands. He works well in that way. I enjoy it.
Okay, cool.
Well, it's 16. I enjoy it middle.
Yeah, right. I think my main bugaboo with this movie, and I feel like a lot of people like this movie. In fact, when we posted the James Bond Ultimate Bondathon on YouTube, you know, the number one comment I get is, man, because I think in that one, too, we rated Man of the Golden pretty low. Maybe the lowest. I can't remember. And a lot of people are like, that's my favorite. That's my favorite. That's my favorite. Yeah. I think this is one of those movies where nostalgia makes a lot of people really like it. I just think, because, you know, it was done in 1974. I think a lot of people just nowadays, they're at a point where that might have been their first movie or one of the earlier ones. Nostalgia just carries it through. And my main issue is that every single thing in this movie, beyond maybe Knick-Knack, because I agree, he's kind of a weird, unique ingredient, has just been done in other movies just better. The locations, the action, everything's just better in other movies to me.
The car stunt is phenomenal. I mean, it's ruined by a sound effect.
That's my point.
Had it been the Bond theme or something like that, that is it is one of the great stunts of the entire series.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, it's got pepper in it, and that's a problem. But I think it's a phenomenally gorgeous stunt.
If you watch it with the volume off, yes. All right.
Yeah.
It's interesting you bring that up because when we did our Bondathon, you know, my friend Wally was the guy who did it. And this is probably his personal favorite Bond movie.
Yeah.
Probably for similar reasons. I know that it was one of his early Bond
That's
films,
what I'm saying.
He loves Britt Eklund to death.
Yeah.
And, he puts it on a pedestal. But, you know, even with the younger people we saw it with who hadn't seen it or only seen it once, they still all got a kick out of it when we watched it. Like, nobody was that harsh on it when we watched it.
It's like, it's so small scale in general. At the end, the bad guy's lair has, like, one dude working there.
Yeah.
And when it explodes, it just looks like a model just collapsed.
Yeah.
I don't know. Well, like I said, my least favorite. But we can move on, I believe, to number 21. Athena, what was our 21st ranked movie?
Number 21 is The world is not.
Oh, no. I think this movie is not nearly as bad as a lot of people seem to give it credit for. I ranked it at number 13. Here's why. Again, all about the villains. I think the villains are fascinating and they have true pathos. It's one of the sexiest movies of the series. The beginning boat chase might be my all-time favorite action sequence of the entire series. I love that sequence. Desmond Llewellyn's Q. I adore Desmond Llewellyn's Q. He gets kind of lucky they got this, but he has a really touching curtain call. I kind of choke up every time I see him descending into the ranks, into the bottom of MI6. And there's some welcome attempts at character and drama and story in this one. It's not just it wasn't just cranked out. However, there's some negative. The big fly in the soup in this one is Denise Richards. She's completely miscast as an annoying nuclear scientist. She was hired, I think, for two reasons alone. Both are somewhere above her navel and below her neck, I would say. And with the exception of the boat chase, the action scenes, like the ski chase or the really boring final fight on the submarine, they're filmed in a very workmanlike manner. The camera's never moving. Yeah. It's very just like it's there. At least it's clear what's happening. I'll give it that. But it just lots of lockdown shots that would have been better with like moving cameras. Yeah. So I rank it number 13. Bob, where do you put it?
The world is not enough. Not enough for Bob. I rank this 25.
25. Oh, wow. Okay, so that's a spread.
I have hated this movie. Look, as you say, lots of possible character development and depth.
Possible. I like how you say possible.
The key word in what you said was attempt. Attempt. Okay. It never really succeeds for me.
Okay.
Lots of nice ideas. It just goes off the rails. I will say I like the title tune by Garbage.
Yeah.
I think it's rather nifty. David Arnold turns in a pretty good score. He's starting to get in the techno thing, but he's balancing.
And we should mention, this is one of the few times where the title theme was interwoven well with the score. Mm-hmm. In the modern day,
Barry.
Right, after Barry, which very rarely actually happened in the modern era of Bond. I appreciate how we hear the world is not enough theme throughout the score, cohesively written in like the Barry scores.
Because they let David Arnold actually have a hand in the title tune. Anyway, I agree. Action scenes feel very languid and long and boring.
Mm-hmm.
I include the boat chase. I thought that whole opening is like two openings smashed together. It's we have the bank, and then we have exposition, and then we have boat chase.
Yep.
And I always thought the boat chase was just too long and crazy, and the boat goes on land randomly at times.
No, it's rocket powered. It's rocket powered boat.
What the hell are you talking about?
It's rocket powered. It's rocket powered.
I never understood that. I'm like,
it's rocket powered, dude. It's Q. It's Q made his own boat. Q was going to make that thing go on land.
You want to know what? If a gondola can turn into a hovercraft, then show me his little fishing boat can do that too.
It did.
Don't just put it on land and go, well, it's just
rockets. Dude, rockets. Come on.
Cartoon. Let's see. So yeah, didn't care for any of that. Look, we get Bond skiing again. I love Bond skiing. Bond skiing is something I dig. Yeah. And we get Bond skiing with cool dudes in parachutes and on snowmobiles. It's right out of a Man from U.N.C.L.E. episode. It's great and it's boring. Why is it boring? It shouldn't be boring.
The way it was filmed and edited.
Fine.
Yeah.
I do like Q's goodbye scene. Mm-hmm. John Cleese, though, didn't care for him.
Mm. What did you think about him in Die Another Day?
Better, but still, I'm not crying tears that he didn't continue in the part.
Gotcha. Okay.
So yes, Denise Richards, awful. You said the same. Horrible puns, horrible dialogue, horrible performance. Not much to say about her beyond she looks nice, but then again, that can be said for a lot of Bond girls. The ending pun is the worst groaner ever in the entire series.
Oh, Christmas comes twice a year?
Well, yeah.
Christmas once only a year? Comes once a year.
I don't even want to, let's just not go there. Let's not go there.
In theaters, I do remember that getting a groan.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
I do too.
An audible groan of, from the audience.
We have a Bond, billed as a villain, really the henchman, Renard, who's told, hey, he can't feel pain. This should lead us to some rather interesting fight scenes. No! It's the most pedestrian fight scene I ever saw with him in Bond. He barely seems... Oh, it's just wasted. Instead, it's all about, oh, I'm emotionally numb or what. Oh, God, I hate it. And then...
love it.
But I will give it credit that this is essentially the first female Bond villain. I will say Elektra is potentially interesting.
just a lot of potentially
she is.
She's potentially interesting, but I just feel like she was a wasted opportunity, and she's a good actress. It's just, oh god, yeah. And then the turnabout, and then all the sort of illusions about the maternal thing with M, and it's like it's like a souffle. It's like a bon quiche that's undercooked. It just doesn't quite rise to the occasion. And I just felt like... it, so it ends up coming across rather melodramatic and kind of daytime soap opera instead of real drama to me.
Gotcha. Okay. All right. Ryan, what are your thoughts on The World Is Not Enough?
I ranked it 23.
Woof.
So you and I are... pretty close on this.
I'm no friend. I'm not friends with you guys anymore.
Oh, that's fine.
I'm glad I'm sitting on the other side of the table.
You know, I like the bank opening sequence a lot.
Yeah.
And I think that could have been enough. I agree. I think the opening sequence is way too long.
Originally, it was the end. Yeah. They added the boat chase.
I think. But I really like him in that opening sequence. I think he's really strong in that. I think Brosnan is quite strong in this.
Yeah,
I'll give you that.
Yeah,
I think he's comfortable. He's relaxed. I like Zukovsky. I'm glad they brought him back. I think he's nice.
Yeah,
I like Elektra. I like Elektra a lot.
I love Elektra.
I find her stunningly beautiful.
Yes,
I have a real issue with the script in this movie. It's just I find the script all over the place.
Convoluted.
There's a moment where Elektra. He's figured something out about her, and he confronts her on it. And then she says this weird dialogue, like you, and where he's literally told her, "You are the bad guy," and she somehow says something that is irrelevant to the story. So I knew that your arm was wounded. You could see that in the funeral. And it was odd because this was the moment where he knew she was the bad person, and somehow she convinced him the other way. I have a real... It just doesn't make sense.
She's perfect in her manipulation.
But I don't think she is. If I can figure it out, then Bond's dumb.
Right, Ryan, you don't like that Bond is kind of played a fool.
He's behind the eight ball a lot in this.
Okay.
I loved the Q scene. As I said, I like M a lot in this series. I don't like her in this. I think this is all kind of boring M stuff.
Okay.
Her getting kidnapped is, I don't need that. I don't like the ski sequence at all.
Yeah.
The ski sequence is absolutely boring. You understand why they're not going after Elektra, but it seems odd in the moment that she's just kind of off to the side. We understand it later and I get that. That's fine. And Denise Richards, she is laughably awful, and she has these moments where she's explaining technical stuff, and you think, boy, anyone could have said this better than her.
Yeah.
Anyone could have. And I love the director. The director has made a phenomenal documentary series.
It's so strange that they picked Michael Apted, though.
Yeah, I mean, his arguably one of the greatest documentary directors of all time has done this huge series, and then he made this, and it was... It's
a really odd choice.
It is an odd choice. But they've done that a couple of times. Sam Mendes is not really the right guy for it either, but that's a different story. But and that tagline at the end, the line, Christmas only. Yeah, I can't. I just can't. honestly, that one line, really.
Right.
That's the reason it's 23.
All right, John.
Number 24.
Oh!
And it could be 25. Because my 25th, actually, I like better than The World Is Not Enough. But I did these by my breakdown, and this landed at 24.
Wow.
I think it's because I gave the Bond girl, who I consider Sophie Marceau, as the Bond girl. Hi, Mars. I think she's great. Great actress. I liked Elektra. I liked a female bad guy. I like their confrontation in the end. I love the torture chair sequence.
But by the way, this movie brings back Bond being tortured, happens.
I like that. Everything goes on in Maiden's Tower, I like.
Yeah, every book he gets tortured in, he barely ever gets tortured in the movies.
Yeah.
Rarely ever.
I like that there's an attempt to bring in some interesting locations. You know, the idea of Baku, Azerbaijan, but they don't really do much with it.
Just looks like a bunch of hills with dirt.
Yeah. But that's about it. I agree with what everyone else has said. I mean, there was an idea to do something deeper and more involved and more interesting and more layered, but it just doesn't work.
Never gets there.
I remember hearing there was going to be a skiing sequence in World of Time, and I'm like, it's 1999, baby, and we're going to get a skiing sequence that's going to top Fear Eyes Only, and it was terrible.
Yeah, it's a
bad one. And so disappointing in a lot of ways, but also, you guys all like Brosnan in it. I don't like Brosnan.
Really? Why not?
I think he's hamming it up. He's overdoing it. He's tortured in every scene. Oh, I'm looking at a picture of Elektra, and let me emote when he confronts Renard down in the reactor.
I think it's complicated internally. Like, I don't know.
It's too much for you. You see the gears of the actor working too hard.
But when he confronts Renard down in the the villain and Bond, yeah. he's trembling with rage. I'm like, take it easy, Bond. It's just, I think he overdoes it throughout the movie. It becomes sort of a domestic thing. Things don't work for me, but enough works for me that it bumped it up to 24, but it's but no way. No means a favorite of mine. Gotcha. Hard to watch.
All right, Athena.
I have World Is Not Enough at number 13.
Yeah, 13, buddies! 13! All right!
There's a lot I like about this movie. I do think Bond is great in this movie. He's seducing all the women. And
still that's... not as many as Roger in View to a Kill, though. Just saying.
Or Sean Connery in Thunderball.
Or Sean Connery in Thunderball. Or from Rush
Hour. Or George in Majesties. But anyway.
Anyway, shut up. Go on.
Yeah. I really like that Electric King is kind of our baddie in this movie. I think that, you know, she is just this strong, manipulative woman who knows what she wants, and that worked really well for me. I like everything in Maiden's Tower. The torture chair is maybe that just turns me on. I don't know. the Q boat scene. I love the Q boat. It's a good chase sequence with this Q boat. I mean, it goes on land. It goes anywhere. Yeah, it's powered by rockets. It's cool. It goes underwater. I love it.
Stupid.
I usually have a problem with Judy Dench's M getting too involved in the stories. I don't have an issue with her in this movie that much. So that's a positive. My negatives are definitely Christmas Jones is too dumb for her job. Like, how did she get this job? She obviously slept with somebody.
tampered with the bomb.
The fight scene in the sub is too long. It's terrible. All of the stunt sequences, I call them stunt sequences because they read as stunt shows. The caviar factory, it's just I'm watching a stunt show, and I feel that is how it is with all of the action sequences in that movie. I'm watching a stunt show.
It feels you're at like the Water World, like stunt show you see at Universal.
Yeah,
like you're exactly. just kind of you hang back like and you're watching.
It looks like a set. It absolutely looks like it's a set.
Interesting,
right?
Yeah.
Not a place right. he was visiting.
Yep.
You're very conscious that you're watching actors and stunts and thing blows up here and then this thing happened.
That's
and,
brilliant. Yeah. I hadn't thought of that. That's really interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, those are, I think, my main points on likes and dislikes.
Yeah. So obviously, I think this is the first real bone of contention we've had here. That's a pretty big split, guys. What is that? Like 10 or 11 different spots away between us two and you three, but I don't think that we can...
It's fallen. I liked it when it came out much more than I do now. It's fallen quite a bit.
So
I loved it when it came out, and it's fallen.
Yeah.
Yeah. I watched it recently, and I had a hard
time. One of my favorite scenes in the movie is the Q-boat. Part of the reason I love that sequence is that shot where there's this crazy chase happening on land, and thing just gets... It's like a good Bond chasing. It's more and more and more outrageous until you have the shot of just diners just calmly eating their food, and then boom, it blasts through. I love it.
It's very classic.
It's very Roger Moore. I love that stuff.
And I love that too.
Yeah, and to me, except for some of the Christmas Jones stuff, I think it successfully, unlike Die Another Day, I think it kind of successfully balances those two of like the very fun stuff with the dramatic, which is why I rank it relatively high.
I do find a lot happens inside of the characters' heads, and I guess maybe I like watching that. I mean, the ski jacket sequence where you know it kind of blows up around them
and
Bond and Electra are in there. I mean she's flipping out, she's having claustrophobia or whatever's going on. I think a lot is going on in their heads in this movie, even when Bond, you know, basically kills her at the end. I mean, there's a lot going on.
There's drama.
When he shoots her, I love that. I think that's great.
Yeah.
I think that's a strong Brosnan moment.
There is drama, and unlike a lot of the movies, there is actual subtext to the scenes. The actors are actually given something to do, not just pressing buttons. I understand that maybe for some people it doesn't all work, but I appreciate the the thought behind it, especially after Tomorrow Never Dies, which is just all action, action, action. I appreciate that, even if it didn't all succeed, that they attempted to go in that right direction, make it more like a Fleming book, and ground it more in drama and characters and character development. And that's, I think, why I put it up so high.
When Electra says goodbye to Renard, that's is really pretty cool.
It's like,
these people are warped. And suddenly you realize, the main bad guy is not the Great Terrorist.
I love it.
He's completely manipulated by her, another good twist. And he has been reduced to being essentially her tool.
Yeah, and when he's kissing her and he's like, you can tell he's like, he can't quite feel it, you know, it's interesting stuff. Yeah.
Again, I say, nice ideas. I never drank the Kool-Aid. I hated it from day one. I walked out of that movie on a date trying to convince my date, these Bond movies are really good.
This is personal stuff.
I have forced myself to watch this film at least a dozen times. I have never.
I walked out of the theater. I was so happy, minus silly Christmas Jones. But
can I ask one thing here? Sure. It does feel to me though that there are parts of the plot that are a bit convoluted. Like when it starts and you have all this stuff about a bank and a kidnapping, then there's this like illusion that M and the guy who died, that they might have been a couple, so Electra might be even like her daughter.
No.
There was a weird illusion there.
I think maybe they were close. They were close.
Also, I should mention, if you read the Raymond Benson novelization, it clears up a lot of that beginning. I think the plot actually works. It makes sense. It's one of the few.
This movie is just really sexy too.
Yeah, it's a sexy movie. It's a kinky, weird, sexy movie.
I think Sophie Marceau is one of the most gorgeous.
Yeah, she is. Yeah. She's beautiful.
I want to make this argument. There is actual chemistry between Bond and the Bond girl, and it's weird because these movies sometimes that chemistry is there. And sometimes it isn't, and it makes all the difference. And it's strange because, like, I guess I'm jumping ahead of myself here, but Tomorrow Never Dies, Michelle Yeoh, terrific actress. Pierce Brosnan, great actor, but there's just no chemistry. You don't see the fireworks. That's something I'm going to harp on, I think, later on in some of the movies that work or don't. Yeah, but I think we can move on to our 20th spot.
But we have a tie.
Ah.
So this is technically 19 and 20.
19 and 20, okay.
Okay, we've got Diamonds Are Forever.
Okay.
Forever.
All right.
Forever with How Do I Live? How Do I Breathe?
Spectre.
Really?
Okay. All right. Wow, you know what? They're kind of similar.
Which one are we going to talk about first?
We'll talk about Diamonds Are Forever first.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Since that is, in the timeline of things, the earliest movie.
Sure. Bob, why don't you start with Diamonds Are Forever?
Diamonds Are Forever, I rated number 20. Look.
Bang on.
Connery is looking old and past his prime, as does even the series in this movie for me. The Vegas setting feels sleazy, not glamorous. We have a death trap with Bond in a coffin. Thrilling stuff till he just gets saved.
Right, deus ex machina.
Yeah,
yep.
Real not a Bond moment for me.
Okay.
It just feels very slow and uninspired. Even John Barry's score feels very laconic, very Vegas-y.
Disagree.
You know, look, I don't hate it. It has grown on me, his score, but, like, especially the Winton Kidd theme. But to me, it doesn't have that rousing quality
Really?
Of a John Barry score. But don't get me wrong, when I'm in the mood for Vegas Lounge Barry, it's great.
Which is like every Monday.
There is a fairly memorable title tune by Shirley Bassey, though. I'll give it that. Jill St. John looks great, but falls under the becomes an idiot in a bikini problem. Because she's a diamond smuggler. She's supposed to be a hardened diamond smuggler. She turns into an idiot.
And she starts out so smart, too. Yeah. And like sassy.
Yeah,
and
sassy
and
everything. Charles Gray makes a very articulate but lightweight Blofeld.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Winton, Mr. Kidd, creepy, but not exactly threatening.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not sure if they work or not. And again, didn't get that at all as a kid. Like, it took me my, I don't know, 10th time.
Oh, is it they're gay?
Yeah, they're gay. Well, I mean, I saw this movie when I was like 6. I had no idea what that
was. Yeah, I wasn't clued in either.
very strange, semi-similar to Quantum of Solace, that technically, although Bond does sleep with the Bond girl, there's only one Bond girl in the movie. As in, I know there's plenty of O'Toole, but he doesn't actually close the deal. You know, so he only has...
He was interrupted, right?
He just sleeps with Tiffany Case over and over and over again. And it's weird for a Connery film, because Connery's usually all over the
place. Yeah.
Just saying. Anyway, Felix Leiter to me is very disappointing in this movie.
Yeah.
He belongs in a Hawaii Five-0 episode, not a Bond film. This plays to me more as an interesting time capsule of Vegas of the 70s than a Bond movie.
Okay.
The end tanker action sequence seems to overstay its welcome. Never liked the fact it was sort of weird and nebulous whether he killed Blofeld or not with the submarine bashing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've always been sort of disappointed with this. Easily Connery's worst Bond movie.
Okay. All right. We'll talk about Diamonds and then we'll go around and we'll go to Spectre. So, Ryan, thoughts on Diamonds?
I ranked it 15.
Okay.
I kind of like the movie. I think it's a lot of fun. I think Connery's having fun in this. I think Connery is happy to be back.
He was very well paid.
Well, right, sure. Yeah, he got well paid for a lot of things for this. So,
yeah.
I think it's a really easy to follow plot. I don't think there's a lot of
really.
I don't have a problem with that.
I gotta disagree with you when we get to mine.
Yeah, I like Tiffany at the beginning.
I think she's great at the beginning.
I think she's a lot of fun. I love the song. I love the score. I know you said that. I think the opening sequence is strong. Connery's kind of tougher in that sequence than he is in the rest of the film.
Sure.
So it's a little out of place, but I still like it. It's that weird connection to a film that he wasn't in. So
right.
So it's like we're gonna connect it, but we're not gonna connect it.
Right.
So it's a little out of place in that sense.
It's like Quantum of Solace.
It is. Why do Wynton Kidd bury him? I've never understood that. That's
right.
Just an odd choice.
Yeah, how is he going to die in
that
scene? There's nothing that makes sense.
And Blofeld's kind of boring. I don't find him. I find him fun to watch, but that's about the only thing. I don't find him menacing in the slightest. And Wynton Kidd, I mean, I guess gay characters in movies, you know, there really weren't many back then. So although it's never really, it's only kind of implied, is. It's interesting, so.
Okay.
There you go. That's fine.
John?
I ranked it number 9.
Oof.
9?
And it could be that it was my first, so you can never separate from that. But I really like Diamonds Are Forever. I think Connery's great in it. I even though he looks a little out of shape, he has that all-pros grace, and he just walks through this movie with command. He's sexy. He's cool. I think he's much better in this than even You Only Live Twice.
John, can I just say that I think we're in agreement here. I don't think that we have a problem with James Bond being old.
Yeah.
I think we have a problem in is he presented in a way that makes sense. And then with View to a Kill, I think an old Bond just felt weird and out of place, and he doesn't fit with this MTV universe and these young girls. This movie didn't bother. Jill St. John comes off, at least in the beginning, is very mature. Like I agree with you. He does look old, but
it doesn't bother me.
Yeah, it doesn't bother me either.
In fact, he doesn't look old now watching it.
Yeah,
he's
right.
He's not that old.
Right.
He's a little out of shape, but he's more like Roger in Octopussy.
Yeah.
It's like he is in command.
Yes.
The music, I think, is fantastic.
Yes.
I think it's haunting. I think it sweeps over the movie. I think the whole movie has a weird otherworldly quality that the music gives it.
Yeah.
But also just the characters and the situations he gets into. I love Wynton Kidd.
Okay.
I love two odd henchmen that are such sadists. They're just there for the fun of it. For the fun of killing. And they're going to do something a little kinky and odd.
Scorpion
every
scene.
Time. The
yeah,
scorpion,
I like
even
that.
Even putting Bond in the thing. Let's just come up with something really sadistic. I think they're great.
They are sadistic.
And I love Tiffany Case. I think the initial scene where they meet, she's
so good.
Dynamite. The elevator fight is fantastic. I like Blofeld as a villain. And Charles Gray, to me, I think, is a good Blofeld. I enjoy him. It's fun now. Like you said, it's more of a time capsule of Vegas. I think the Vegas sequences are maybe the weak point in the movie. But I still find it very easy and enjoyable to watch.
Yeah.
Athena.
Diamonds Are Forever is number 24 for me.
Ooh.
Really low.
Wow, I think that's the biggest split we've had so far.
Yeah.
9 and 24.
Yeah.
I mean, to me, it's like, okay, well, this is, you know, a big about Blofeld, and he's not menacing, and he's bland, so I'm agreeing with some comments.
Blandfeld.
There. Blandfeld, yeah. Wit and Kid are not witty, and they're just like kids bumbling about. but on the opposite side of that, I do like Bambi and Thumper, and I like them taunting Bond.
Oh, yeah, Bambi and Thumper also. Yeah. I love that.
So I like them, and I do like Tiffany, even when she gets kind of dumb. I enjoy the car chase through Vegas and the silly moon buggy chase. It's the most ridiculous thing ever, and I like it. Q in Vegas trying to win, you know, he's just using his gadgets to win money. That's amusing to me.
Yeah.
So there you go. But it's bland, and I'm just like, why? Why? And Bond kicks a cat, kind of, and that pisses me off.
That's true.
I forgot about that.
He kicks the cat.
Oh, yeah, the outside hanging off the White House. I love that sequence.
Yeah, that's kind of cool, yeah.
He lands on a toilet, which is a little odd, but that's...
The harpoon gun thing, yeah.
Yeah,
that's good.
My thoughts on Diamonds Are Forever. The witty, hilarious dialogue. I put this at 23rd. But like I said, except for Man with the Golden Gun, I like all the movies. This is a perfectly watchable movie. I just watched it today, actually, in preparation for this. But yeah, it's just boring, and it just feels like it goes on for about 20 minutes too long. But the hilarious dialogue and the double entendres, so good.
Yeah.
Never better than this movie. Yeah. The John Barry score, this is John Barry getting back to his jazz roots. And is all the better for it. I love the score of this movie. It's one of his best. The Vegas backdrop, really neat. It is such a treat to see that Vegas and see how it really was. And, like, it looks so cool and so different than this kind of sleek, glossy, super big buildings. I just love seeing that. Charles Gray, easily the weakest Blofeld of all the Blofelds. And it's just unforgivable that he dresses as a woman. That bugs the hell out of me. The Winton kid as an evil gay couple. It's got some kind of uncomfortable 70s homosexual stereotypes in there that's kind of uncomfortable. Like him going, woo! And he gets, like, before he dies with the tails between his legs.
I love that ending.
I don't mind it.
It's
a product of its time.
Okay, fair enough. But I'm just saying, right now, I watch it every time, I'm like, ooh. The laughable effects sequences, where they just superimpose an explosion over a helicopter instead of actually blowing up a helicopter or a model like they usually do. They got really cheap and lazy with the effects in this one, and the space effects look weird, and and that stupid pink tie, that dumb pink tie, I'm sorry, it bugs the hell out of me each time. And I'm going to disagree with you, Ryan. I think the plot is so overly complicated. The part in the middle about the diamonds and who has the diamonds, where's the real money for the real diamonds, and where's the real diamonds, and where'd they put the diamonds in the guy and the body, and it's just try to follow it, it's impossible to follow.
Right.
It doesn't kill it. I'm just saying, I don't look at this as a very simple to follow plot. It's actually really overly complex. What really kills it for me is how the last act it's so boring and plotting on the oil rig. We're talking about boring action sequences. There's no music through most of it, which is weird. It's just, we're watching, I don't know, just boring, boring ending. Just kind of a boring movie.
But you get to see a cassette tape in and out of Tiffany Case's bottom.
See, I love that.
That sounded weird. The way that you said that was an interesting visual.
Bikini bottom.
Okay, there we go. Okay.
The diamonds going all over the place. It is confusing. It's really confusing. I love him in the coffin though. I love Bob in the coffin.
I'm with Bob. It's a cheap out. It's unearned. It's one of the
up to the out. It's nice.
It's great. You're like the first time you watched it. Like, how the hell is he going to get out of this one? And the answer was he just bailed out.
Yeah.
He doesn't come up with his wits or his gadget or whatever to come out. He just cheated out. So, yeah.
The film always seemed very very dark to me. There's a lot of dark scenes in those casinos. There's that weird scene with the ape woman.
But it was real. That really existed in Vegas.
I'm sure it did.
Yeah.
There was some sort
Diamonds also, it's very much of a Cubby, because this is when they split and they started doing Cubby and Harry.
This is a Cubby movie?
This was a Cubby movie.
Okay.
And it has a lot of Cubby stuff in it. Cubby worked for Howard Hughes. Cubby worked in a mortuary.
Okay.
There's lots of stuff that he sort of brought in. So I've really kind of felt the cubbiness of this movie.
Interesting. The cubbiness.
Yeah.
It feels like a Cubby movie.
Yeah. And also, great Winton kid moments.
Yeah.
When they've killed Mrs. Whistler and she's being hauled out of the lot.
Oh,
you take her picture.
For the kids.
For the kids.
Mrs. Whistler didn't want some photos for the children.
That's
right.
I love that.
And then they just pan over to Bond driving up to the house. Yeah. And that's like, boy, this is good.
I love all of that stuff.
You know what?
I think Amsterdam is gorgeous.
So, by the way, has anyone at this point changed their minds on any rankings?
No.
Because I might end up moving Diamonds up. I think, John, you might have convinced me. I might move it up one spot. I'm going to put a big +1 question mark.
Okay.
But we'll see when we get to the movie I have right above it. We'll see.
Okay.
All right. Let's go to the other, our other number 20/19 number. that tie Diamonds Are Forever.
Spectre.
Ryan, why don't you start?
I ranked Spectre 21. Oof. Yeah, I have a lot of problems with this movie. But on the good side, I love the opening sequence. I think it's one of the best in the series.
The Mexico sequence.
Yeah, the Mexico sequence. I love the opening shot. It is all Bond. I think it's a phenomenal opening sequence. Craig is odd in this movie. There are moments where he really looks like he's enjoying himself, and there's other moments where he looks completely bored, in my opinion. So it's sort of like all over the place. I don't know if he's having a good time. It doesn't really matter. But I love Monica Bellucci in the movie. I would have liked a lot more of her. I think she's age-appropriate. I love the sequence he has with her right before they make love. I love all of that. I wanted a lot more of her. I hated the action sequences. Outside of the opening, I think they're all awful. I think the car chase is gorgeous but boring. The problem with a lot of the sequences is there's no peril to Bond.
Yeah. Hmm. Yeah, he's never in real jeopardy.
Yeah, when he's leaving the headquarters, they're shooting at him. That's the moment where you're a little nervous. Yeah. You're never nervous Bond's going to die. That's not going to happen. But he gets in the car.
Yeah, he's fine.
It's a boring sequence.
He could have stopped the car.
Yeah.
And nothing would have happened.
There was no peril. There's not really a lot of peril in the movie until the ending. The torture sequence, I think, is. I just didn't buy into it. And then all this stuff is done to him, and then he becomes an action hero when he gets out. Your vision's going to be affected and all this. And he's shooting people from 10 yards away. I had a real problem with all that. I thought that was kind of useless. There are a lot of mistakes in the movie that it's just silly mistakes.
Yeah.
In part of the writing. Like, Bond would have shot the camera
when
he's meeting with Mr. White. I bring him back. Mr. White was fine. This movie is a connection film, and I don't think it connects well. I think the movie is a forced film.
What do you mean by
an absolutely forced film? Connecting with Quantum and that everything of Craig had to be shoehorned into this movie.
Oh, like retconned together.
Yeah. I don't think the movie needed to do that. I think that Blofeld, the reveal we all knew, so that I find him not a particularly strong villain, and that's a shame because he could have been great. Yeah. And I think the ending's boring. I think all of that is sorry, I've gone on a little long, but
it's a long movie.
It is way too long for me. It is way too long. I have a real problem with the movie.
So. Okay, John.
I rated it 12.
Wow,
I'm still settling. It's the latest movie, and you know, you're always very keyed up about the latest movie. I recognize all the flaws, but you know, I don't let those destroy it for me. Okay. I've found that I've been watching it over and over and over on Blu-ray, and I kind of want to turn to that more than Craig films that I like a lot better.
Maybe because it's the freshest, though?
Because he's Bond. And it's sort of like for me watching Diamonds Are Forever or Thunderball. It's not a taxi movie. You're watching Bond be Bond in glamorous locations, one after another, moving from place to place. I like all the ideas behind it. I don't think it holds together very well. I love the introduction of Blofeld at the Spectre meeting. I think
yes, and it's I like that. I like that.
How
we went from that moment to the end.
Yeah, right.
Just giggly and raising his eyebrow. It's a shame.
But two different characters.
It's a shame. But I still enjoy Daniel Craig in a big scale classic journeyman Bond movie.
It's a big movie.
So I find Spectre very watchable and enjoyable.
Okay,
12 in the middle.
Right. Athena,
interesting. Spectre was number 19 for me. My biggest problem with the movie is that I don't believe the connection between Bond and the main Bond girl.
Madeline Swan.
Yeah. I just don't see it. She's so serious through the whole thing. She never smiles.
The chemistry that I was talking about earlier.
There's a lack of chemistry. Yeah. I feel like the main Bond girl should have been Monica Bellucci.
And they had chemistry.
And they definitely had chemistry. I like everything with her in it. Blofeld being the adopted brother, just weird. Shouldn't have happened. And worst song ever. It's Sam Smith having puberty problems.
I disagree with you.
But yes, I have issues with James Bond being dumb, like not shooting the cameras out. And just not realizing a lot of stuff is going on. And yeah, how is he all of a sudden Mr. Rambo coming out from being tortured? I like that torture scene, actually. And I like the cat a lot. So that wins points.
The fact that they brought the cat back.
Yeah. I was excited that Spectre was coming back, but I didn't like the delivery. I do like the silly moment in the Rome chase sequence with the slow driver in front of
Hans. Yeah, the Fiat. Yeah,
it's so Roger Moore. Yep. And that's
great. I wanted
great.
More of that. I would have liked more Roger Moore-esque stuff.
Yes. I really like Q, and I like that he's in the movie more. The his avoiding the bad guys coming down in the gondola, I enjoy a lot. And him and Bond have great interactions.
Yeah, it's true.
And I like the design of the new MI6. I thought the sequence at the end in the old MI6 is, again, Bond being dumb. It's just, it doesn't make sense, this whole ending. And why is he at the end walking off with this girl who, he doesn't know anything about this girl.
Yeah, I rated this number 22, but I think I'm going to knock it down to 23. I originally had, so interesting as you're tied, originally I had Diamonds Are Forever at number 23 and Spectre at 22. And after kind of listening to everybody and thinking about this, I think I got to flip them. I think that I got to rechange it so that Diamonds Are Forever will be my 22nd and Spectre will be 23. As far as like Madeline Swan, it's not, you don't need to have chemistry with Bond and the Bond girl all the time. However, at this one, it gets to like another level of like, I love you and like, I'm going to quit the service and be with you. Yeah. And he does it a couple of times in like Majesties and Casino Royale. And I believe it because there's chemistry there. And man, there's just no chemistry. It's just not unearned at all. What I do like, it's a gorgeous movie. It's kind of boring, but it's a gorgeous movie. Craig finally gets to be the veteran slick Bond. Yeah. We all know and love. Finally, he's just James Bond, and it's great. I like the scale. Welcome Return to the Old School charms. This is a thing. Craig is finally pitted against the first formidable henchman we've seen in ages. Mm-hmm. David Batista is barely in it, but he's great, and it's the... I can't remember before this, maybe Stamper, maybe in Tomorrow Never Dies, where Bond was actually pitted against a real imposing, villain.
Well, his introduction in the Spectre meeting is so good.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so creepy and gives shivers.
Yeah.
One of the
especially really with Craig, who's like, Mr. Bodybuilder, and they keep on, putting up against all these, very cookie-cutter generic henchmen, and this one they finally like, we're going to make a henchman. I really appreciate that. The negatives, though. Bloated runtime. Repeats too many of the themes we just saw in Skyfall about the agency trying to shut down a 00 section. It's the same thing. It's so boring. It's unforgivable to have Bond and Blofeld have a family connection. The score, so weak sauce. It's a near track-for-track repeat of Skyfall. There's a lot of repetitiveness with Skyfall. I think it's the worst title theme song ever. It's so boring. The lyrics make no sense for Bond. It was written by Sam Smith's own admission in like 20 minutes, and it just shows...
I think that's so disrespectful.
Yeah, I do too. I mean, spend more than 20. You are joining a fraternity, and the fact that I won an Academy Award still like blows me away. Bond has some of the illest fitting suits of the entire series. They are about three sizes too small,
too tight.
Bunchy. And I know I'm being nitpicky. Don't like
Ford
it.
Like the look. Suits for a certain type of body type, and Craig is not that body type.
But in like Quantum of Solace, they fit great. So I don't know if they're just trying to push it too far or whatever, but it's like in a Bond movie, Bond should look great, and I like what he's wearing and ideas, but like the design of it's great, but they're just always way too small, way too bunchy, and like the whole film looks like it was shot through a filter labeled urine. Just doesn't look that. It just doesn't like where they're going is cool. The locations are great, but the cinematography is compared to Skyfall, just kind of seems muddy and yellow.
Yeah, it's called film.
Zing! All right, excellent.
That was awesome.
Bob, what are your thoughts?
I rated Spectre 17. And I'm still in a bit of a tiz about it because, as you say, it's the latest one. And I pretty much agree with just about everything people have said. Lack of chemistry with the Bond girl, especially with the Love You stuff. The terrible shoehorn interconnection in the movies that really doesn't totally make sense and was added on later. Blofeld is Bond's sort of adopted brother. Terrible.
Yeah, Blofeld in general being a waste of Christoph Waltz, who should have been awesome.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Terrible title song. Rerun City of the score by Thomas Newman.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know. I mean, it's got moments, but this one does not add to a satisfying whole. It's just, it plays like a giant homage to the Roger Moore era, which in one way is cool. I'm all about that. But it does jar a little with what they've established with Craig. So some minutes you're getting kind of this sort of serious Craig stuff, and other minutes, as you say, you're getting the airbag guy.
It's kind of like Die Another Day, and that the tone is a little all over. Yeah, yep.
But I mean, you literally have like, okay, look, I like the opening helicopter scene too, because that's like a total For Your Eyes Only moment. I was like, wah! Yep. And then we get an airplane taxi thing, like Live and Let Die, and then you get like a ski thing, and you get all these kind of Roger Moore-y moments. I'm like, that's kind of cool, but this is weird to see. But as you say, it's cool to see Craig in a straight-up Bond movie.
Right.
But it's like they didn't fully...
They didn't make a good Bond movie.
Yeah, they didn't streamline it, especially after, you know, such a... I mean, I know we might be a little split on it, but I really like Skyfall, and I thought, oh, man, to have this be the follow-up is kind of...
And the same team.
And the same team.
Yeah.
At bottom line, it just did not feel as thought out or as compelling as the last one.
And the fact that they had so much time to write it.
Yeah.
It's kind of... Like Quantum of Solace, I can kind of forgive it because they had no time. They had to just rush it together.
Right.
And, like, the actors are writing scenes. This movie, they had a great screenwriter. They had forever. They had, like, what is it, 3 or 4 years to make this one movie? And yet it still is just... Still feels and was rushed.
It felt like they regretted creating Quantum, and they're like, "Whoops! Oh, we meant Spectre."
That's the thing.
Yeah.
Is this never felt like the Spectre that I've come to know?
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
a very different Spectre.
They
it's
also
not
never
the Spectre
spell
that I
out
wanted.
What Spectre means?
Well, right.
They never do.
That's what that in
it's
a boring called Spectre. How do you not say what
it,
that means?
It, because it's not. It's not the same Spectre. That's my problem with it. I also have a problem with the ski sequence. He almost kills her in that ski sequence. He rams into the back of that truck that she's sitting in that allegedly he's trying to save.
Yeah.
I really wanted at the beginning. I wanted the helicopter to land on the roof of the building that he was in, and he was going to go back to her.
That would have been a Roger
Moore
moment.
But I wanted that. That's a Bond moment.
Yeah,
still.
That would have been good.
And he doesn't do that.
Sorry, I was late. And
sorry,
titles.
I was like, I think that would have been great.
Well, you know, one thing also that. Now I'm thinking about it that bugs me is that I feel like this Daniel Craig in this movie is totally driven by the mission, and nothing else matters. And to me, that actually isn't what Bond is. Like, the fact that it's flat is just a disaster area. That is not Fleming's Bond. Fleming's Bond had everything in its right place, in the exact right order. He would hire a housekeeper, May, or whoever, to, like, do... Right. It's just, there's weird things where they kind of get Bond right in some ways, but then in others, they're like, no, I think Bond would have stopped in, like, you know...
Right, right.
Stopped for the Mexican girl. Like, why not? You know? But no, this Bond is all about the mission. He's got to have a life. And he doesn't have a life, and that's his arc. But it's a weird arc for Bond to have, because Bond is always about... living life, you know what I mean? Like, he's not
his
just
apartment
the...
certainly wasn't right. We get that sort of idea that he.
But do you get to see Bond's apartment?
Well, yeah, but it's not right. It's not right. That is not how Bond's apartment should be. Right.
He goes rogue again. This is another.
Yeah, right.
Another rogue Bond film.
And with that note, we're going to take a break. That is going to be the end of part one. Please listen in to part two, where we will actually finish ranking all these movies.
Because one part is never enough.
Exactly.
Stay tuned.